Let's get started. We're going to have two people who are going to give some quick remarks before our main speaker, a current student and another alum. And so, Lauren, if you want to take over.
Good evening. My name is Lauren Filler. I'm a graduate student in the Master's in Public Administration, and I'm specializing in sustainable communities. In my past 5 years at Binghamton University, from freshman to graduate student, I've learned a lot about sustainability. Not just the science, the economics, the social impacts. I've learned how the Binghamton community engages with and thinks, or doesn't think, about the environment, climate change, and environmental justice. Binghamton University, like many college campuses, is a bubble. We're not aware of what is going on around us, such as the impacts of industry over time in the Southern Tier. Similarly, we fail to see how the actions on our campus affect the local and global communities. What concerns me is the lack of knowledge of the importance of creating a sustainable world, and further, how each action has implications. The decision to drive a car versus to take a blue bus to campus, the daily choice to consume meat instead of local vegetables, the decision to not bring reusable bags to the grocery store and bring plastic ones and take plastic ones each time. From my experience, Binghamton students are intelligent and have great capacities to learn. But that does not mean that they have the awareness or the knowledge needed to make necessary changes. I do not believe that creating a sustainable world is up to individuals alone. Institutional and systemic changes must be made through new policy, socially responsible companies, and changing cultural understandings. Universities like this one have the ability, and in my opinion, the obligation, to create these new paradigms. We can do this through actions and words. The words are the knowledge we share with students, teaching us why and how to treat the planet, our neighbors and generations, and future generations as well. The action is leading the way through more sustainable practices. I'm proud to see that Binghamton is at a turning point, creating a new master's degree, supporting sustainable research, investing in the living building. We have the opportunity to really change the conversation and the future. My hope is that when we have important talks, like the one tonight, and make important changes on campus, we are not siloed from the rest of the university or the rest of the world. This conversation cannot succeed if it is simply among a subsection of the population or a bubble within our ivory tower. For substantive change, everyone across all backgrounds, all income levels, and different fields of study must think about the environmental implications of their actions. I hope that after the discussion tonight, you take the time to share what you have learned with someone else, someone, a peer, a teacher, a friend, who may not know or care about sustainability, but should know about the important changes and conversations happening here in Binghamton. I would now like to take a moment to introduce the next speaker, Edward McGraw, who will then introduce our main speaker. Mr. McGraw has taken the lessons he learned at Binghamton and brought them out into the world. He received his Bachelor of Science in Business at Binghamton University. And then he went on to obtain his Master's of Architecture from Syracuse University and registered to practice architecture in the state of New York. Mr. McGraw is the founding partner and chief executive officer of Ashley McGraw Architects, located in Syracuse, New York. Under his direction, the firm has pioneered a foundational shift towards design that understands and participates in the relationship between our built and natural environment. Mr. McGraw has been integral in greening the Southern Tier, having his hand in projects such as the Southern Tier High Tech Incubator and the MacArthur School. And of course, the newest initiative, which is underway here, the Binghamton University Living Building. Please join me in welcoming Ed McGraw.
Well, good evening, everyone. I have a simple pleasure, and that is to introduce Aaron Mair. And I have the official bio, which I will read, and then I'd like to make some observations from my own research and some wonderful conversations we've had today. And I appreciate Lauren not saying you're a graduated here. Aaron Mair is the Sierra Club's 57th president. He became a Sierra Club member in 1999 following a decade-long battle in which he led to shut down a polluting solid waste incinerator in an inner-city community in Albany. His efforts ultimately led to a commitment by the state to shut down the facility and a $1.6 million settlement to that community. Mair was also a key figure in leading the fight and securing the Sierra Club's participation in the Clean Up the Hudson campaign, which resulted in the settlement between the EPA and General Electric to dredge toxic PCBs from the upper Hudson River. He has held more than three dozen leadership positions within the Sierra Club's Hudson Mohawk Group and Atlantic Chapter, including Chapter Chair, Chapter Executive Committee, the Environmental Justice Chair, and he was elected to the National Sierra Club's Board of Directors in 2011. Throughout his tenure with the club, Mair has demonstrated an unwavering commitment to grassroots action, environmental justice, and transforming the culture of the Sierra Club to make it, in his words, a more welcome environment to all people, regardless of their race or socioeconomic status. Some other things. A proud 1984 alum of our fine institution. For the past 25 years, he's been involved and worked diligently in environmental justice, which means diversity, equity, inclusion. He really caught my eye in the work that he's done in fighting against the tar sands and for clean power and social justice and economic sustainability. He, in fact, is a man of his principle, was explaining to me today how he was arrested in protest in D.C., speaking up for justice. And he's a deep systems thinker and somebody that believes what we've just been talking about, the true sustainability is, of course, environmental sustainability. But it's also social justice and economic inclusion. And it's my distinct pleasure and honor to welcome and introduce Aaron Mair.
I want to say, first and foremost, thank you all for in this university for not only being my home, but a welcoming and, as they say, challenging and inclusive place. So those rare opportunities you get to come back to where you began to not only talk about your journey in the world after you left here, but also your contributions that you were able to make as a result of being here. When we talk about today's latest terms in technology, when we talk about environmental protection, sustainable development, one of the critical things that you'll hear that will matter is intersectionality. And this is something that is very true. But before I get to that intersectionality, let me talk to you about the man who came here from a working class community, son of a General Motors UAW Union Shop student organizer, one of nine children, in fact, the middle of nine children. The first in their line to go on to college to get a college education. My father and my mother did not have high school educations. My father went into World War II. He was a hard left organizer in Harlem during the 40s. They had a very active labor movement. It was okay even to be a member of the Communist Party. It was just like being a part of any other political party. It's not until years later in the 50s that you get all the Red Scare and the crazy stuff. But very serious labor organizing. But I say that to say this, a lot of those core principles is learned at the hips and heels of a father who spoke in the best that he could understand about the need for his son to not be a blue collar, but to get a white collar job and a white collar education. And so in honor of that memory, you know, I went on to this school. But still, it was a blue collar background. Back then, okay, during the 60s, okay, since there's a lot going on in my generation, I had to deal with the death of Dr. King, the death of RFK. My generation was that generation of crisis, challenge, and confronting, as they say, the old order and change. And one of the great things that came out, not only out of that, was not only the civil rights movement, okay, as well as the various student movements against the Vietnam War, but also the ecology movement, you know, and I wanted to lay that as a foundational principle, because a lot of folks, and even to this day, I get a lot of folks who tell me, this is a lot of the things, the journey that you're taking the Sierra Club on, as you know, that's social justice. It has nothing to do with the environmental movement. The modern environmental movement, as you know today, is anchored in all those movements of struggle. In fact, its principles of nonviolent civil resistance and engagement are actually borrowed from the civil rights struggle. You cannot talk about a modern ecology and a modern environmental movement without talking about that earlier intersectionality. But as we go to universities and move on, we start to specialize in certain things and we adopt modes of exclusion. So when one takes out a principal position, say, well, I'm a conservationist, and that conservation has nothing to do with civil rights or economic justice and all these other factors. I just care about preserving this particular place and space, and that's what I'm here for. Then you really never understood John Muir, okay? You never really understood John Muir. Because one of the things about John Muir and one of his famous sayings, you know, when we try to pick out anything by itself, we find that it's hitched to everything else in the universe. 1911. It's a powerful intersectional statement, but true. It was recognizing that we were losing our pristine places and spaces and what connected us to the land and space due to rapid industrialization. And at that juncture, he held the first outing in which he invited a president from the state of New York, who had a connection with the great outdoors, Teddy Roosevelt, to come see Yosemite. And how many people here have been to Yosemite? And I encourage everybody to go. When you get there, you see why Yosemite was a special indigenous American sacred space before they were eventually, in the pursuit of saving that place, removed from that place, as they did removed or through disease or war or conflict, pushed from a lot of their lands and their heritage places and spaces. But still, it is an awe-inspiring place and space by which one can really become connected and realize how small you are, but also the work you have to do. But again, Muir was not the only one who had this observation. And the reason why I put Muir and King there is not only all, but again, this has always been a power intersectional argument. And again, Dr. King recognize that common mutuality, the intersection of economic class, caste, status, race, and how we're using this land space, right? A lot of the civil rights and voting rights are voting for people who control the legislative decision-making and the rulemaking, the regulatory framework by which we share, live, either next to one another, but how we occupy this space. So intersectionality of these things are very critical. Oftentimes in universities, I said, you know, you go off into your particular majors and you feel that it's safe for me to focus within my field especially, not realizing that it is connected to all these things. And so an interdisciplinary approach is something that's critical. And I'm actually glad to see that at this point in time that the university is actually creating curriculum and interdisciplinary cross-pollinization of programs so that students can get a full 360 experience in not only their education, but the need that they need to tap into other spaces. When I came here in the late 70s, there was no such interdisciplinary program. And more importantly, when I came here, as I mentioned, I came here as a son of a working class family. Well, I had all the raw passion, the raw talent, and all the raw materials to be a serious student. I still had a lot of gaps, okay, because of my socioeconomic status. Now, granted, I did not have the language or the skill set, or the intellectual tools to categorize and help frame my case. But there were people here that helped me develop those skills. So my greatest thank you is a program called the Transitional Year Program. When I came here, it was an EOP program, and it was called a Transitional Year Program. What it recognized is that when people who come in as freshmen in general, there's always a challenge in the cultural shift and the cultural adjustment. But imagine that challenge in cultural shift and cultural adjustment when you are the first generation of your family who have no context by which you are able to pull that together. You're not the second, third, or fourth generation of iteration and experience in economic status. So having a program and leaders here that help you shape and get that intellectual, as they say, act somewhat together so that you can start to be a student here is a very important piece. But not only do you have to integrate and migrate from your culture, You had to assimilate into a new culture, but also you had to run at full steam in a new environment. Now let's be clear, Binghamton then prided itself on being the Harvard of the SUNY schools. And so in other words, not only did you have to come here and swim fast, but you had to swim fast in theory than other students. That was the legend of the night. So I mean, I was quaking in my boots. And you had to overcome all that, as I said again, and develop a skill. So there's somebody in the audience, Linda Lisman, can you just raise your hand? So do want to embarrass you. Because one of the things that you had to develop was the skills to communicate, and rhetoric was one of the areas that she really gave you what I call guerrilla English. And for any radical, you had to basically have your persuasive arguments and you had to make those cases. But more importantly, just the fundamental structures of language. A lot of kids nowadays, they recognize that kids are graduating from high school, now they're onto it. But thanks to programs like TYP, it gave even this university the space to recognize that not just minority kids, a lot of freshmen were coming in without the sufficient skills to have. So I think in expanding this thing to all the kids in the general population. But it's very powerful. It's very powerful. In fact, I use one of Linda Lisman's rhetorical devices when I'm arguing, you know, about, as they would say, mountaintop removal, or the coal families, families who depend upon coal in West Virginia. Because when you go to West Virginia, or any place where Native Americans who have, as I say, a particular reservation, to them there are places and spaces where they have been for generations, take on, as they say, that noun meaning. And as they say, when we talk about mountains, the noun use of the environment, things that have sacred meaning to people, or in places where you've been raised for generations, like the hills and hollows of West Virginia, you know, these are not just natural resources. They're nouns. This is where generations of music, culture, heritage, struggle, strife, you know, civilization for that family may have begun. So when you look at those mountaintops and those hills, it's a very significant place when you recognize in the noun sense of that thing, that mountain, those valleys, those hollows, they're very sacred. And oftentimes, the poverty does not give them a tool to defend that place, because when corporations come in, they see that very same mountain. But the English language gives them verbs, and the verbal use of that mountain is like the coal seam, the things that you value, things that doesn't, you know, turns that thing into a resource to be used and act upon or be part of action. So to them, they don't have a noun sense of place. To them, like with the First Nations that are right now fighting the Dakota Access Pipeline, they don't have a sense of that noun place of this is the burial ground of ancestors, this is the hunting ground, this is something sacred. To them, they got that verbal sense in use. And so what they see, in the case of West Virginia, they look at that same mountain and say, man, look at all that crap in the way of my coal seam. And they will do whatever they need to do, pass whatever laws and regulations and policies that they would need to strip away, blow up that mountain, what they call mountaintop removal, and destroy that vista, that place, that space that probably held generations of family together in spite of them working as slaves in the verbal sense to help mine the coal in other places of points within that same valley. Or in the case of First Nations, moving them off of their sacred lands and sacred places so they can run through another pipeline or a fracking well that will defile that sacred place. And so one of the things I realized early on that I needed a language and a toolkit that would help me express how my culture, custom, and heritage is connected to certain things, and that they're not things, they're not verbal things to be used and exploited. So coming to this place and getting those skills and having the various players here that helps provide you with those access and those tools, it's a very critical piece. And so from that, I get to say thank you. It's a long thank you. But I don't want to just say thank you and not explain the context of that thank you, because I have taken that argument as well as many other arguments in helping that language to persuade policymakers, presidents, congressmen, state office holders, governors, corporations, with regards to what something means. The battle for the Hudson River, up until we got involved, it was actual conservationists and environmentalists, to them they felt it was appropriate just to have the argument of science against General Electric. Now, General Electric, you know, this is the company that Thomas Edison founded, right? This is the company that's got more Nobel scientists and prizes and patents on this. Like, how in the heck are a bunch of environmentalists going to out-science these guys? Well, lo and behold, we comes along Harbor Hill Environmental Justice. It's the people's seat. What is the culture, custom, and heritage rights of people who are living off of the fish in the Hudson River, albeit polluted? The intersectionality of that culture, how that what that river means to them, not as a resource to be exploited and polluted, but provides them sustenance so that they don't have to go for food stamps, whatever. I live off of Hudson River fish. You know, thank God for the Clean Water Act, because we always had something called the Peekskill Stroke prior to the Clean Water Act. And this is where you're out moving that material out of the way. I think Peekskill swimmers were probably the best breaststrokers there were, because you had to move that debris out of your way. But the point of the matter is, you know, because of that diversity, and because of the diversity of tools that I was able to pick up here, I was able to express those connections and what places and spaces mean. And this is one of the things that only, as they say, a multidisciplinary approach with regards to your training and development are critical in regards to, A, not only building a movement, but articulating what that movement's about. Does anybody know where Dr. King was killed? Not the old folks. Young folks. Anyone, just shout it out. Popcorn. Memphis. Right? And he was killed doing what? A lot of kids, because a lot of them just grow up because they get to the school, so he was assassinated doing civil rights. Yes. But what specifically? It was a garbage workers' strike. He was striking for 10 cents to be added to the living wage of garbage workers in Memphis. And this is what he died for, the intersectionality of not only just the issues of race, but labor rights, a living wage. He was a threat to increasing the cost of those who leverage racism and the Jim Crow South and segregation, you know, which is really what this is about. You know, again, anything that we can use to stratify, again, a social stratification that I picked up here under James Geschwinder, were very powerful tools to help break down that argument and help me see very deeply even what my dad was talking about. That yes, we can have labor come together and fight for rights, but you know something, the white guys are over there and the black guys are over there. You would think that they would all be coming together fighting for the same wage, but somebody feels that because of their race, they might get a little something extra so they can betray the movement. But at the end of the day, capitalist doesn't care about that. The issue is the final cost. And if the threat is a guy coming inside and stirring up and agitating not only for voting rights and other rights, because at the end of the day, these things are all connected to the ability of somebody to negotiate for a fair wage. And another thing about the Memphis strike, because I come back there decades later as one of the activists fighting against a number of the Superfund sites around Memphis. Memphis garbage strike, where he was killed at, it's one of the most toxic, polluted communities in the country. Bear, Dow, all the ortho products were produced and dumped in and around the landfills in Memphis. And this is the very place. Not only was he fighting for these workers to have 10 cents, but they were getting 10 cents low-level wages in a community and in jobs, and granted, as trash haulers, hauling some of the most toxic, hazardous waste to unlined landfills where their communities, because of their poverty, live right, as they say, right on top of. So the irony that he died for fighting for labor rights and for wage rights, while at the same time for land and in a place where that physical environment was killing the very people that he was fighting for. And so when you talk about in civil rights are separate from environmental rights, nonsense. This man was at the forefront. The issue is that of framing. The issue is that of analysis of history. And again, it's the intersectionality of seeing how these things tie together that frame, as I say, define the arguments and constructs that we have to deal with. bear with me. A lot of things that the environmentalists fight, but usually we're at the back end of any fight. It's usually after a piece of legislation has been passed, a rule has been passed, a zoning ordinance has been made, that then, if it is in our backyard, residents organize, rise up. As I say, they petition against, they try to stop it, but at the end of the day, it's usually at the back end of the process. What environmental justice and civil rights adds to this movement, it recognizes from our experience that we have been often divided based upon our socio-demographic values. This is why they hire those consultants. They look at the areas, the land use, whatever they're going to put in. You know, what do people think about it? What communities have the education to process and be aware of what's going on? And more importantly, their ability to react and respond. And these are big things that go into where something is cited and zoned. But the critical point is, it is the political process that decides how our land is used. It is our zoning, okay, that decide where negative amenities, like landfills, hazardous waste facilities, waste treatment plants, will be sited, where schools will be sited, which is a positive amenity, hospitals, universities. You know, in fact, many recognize that a positive amenity like a university next to a person's property does what to its value? Increases it. Well, at the same token, a negative amenity like a hazardous waste transfer station next to somebody's property does what? Decreases it. And one of the things that socioeconomic status does, you know, because socioeconomic, you tell me somebody's income, I can tell you their education and their responsiveness to whether or not something's going to be permitted and sited and zoned in their area. But also how dense, how many people are going to be packed into an area. These are land use decisions that are occurring at a political level. So to discuss political science and not really tell folks the real truth that this political science impacts all these other things and look at it in a vacuum, it's just a mistake. But more importantly, to think that you're going to be an economics major or an engineer or a planner and not realize that you have to be aware of, as I talk about, the sociocultural aspects, the anthropological aspects, the human dependencies in connection with space, and not look at these things in a dynamic systems way, you know, you're doing yourself a disservice. And so one of the critical things that civil rights gives us is that we recognize at the front end, it is your politicians that basically are the ones who are elected to create the legislation, the regulatory framework, the rules that tell you exactly where and how people are going to be living within the community, who gets in, who gets out. But equally and more importantly, they're the ones who appoint the zoning and land use commissions. They're the ones that decide where these things are going to be placed in space. Now, we can talk about all these things, but here's the other wrinkle to these things. Because not only does class and caste influence this whole process, but race does. And you cannot look at these things de facto or as they are right now or as they are today. These things, like anything, like a coral reef, these are institutions on top of institutions on top of institutions. And so you have to drill down into this whole process, as I said, to really question and begin to understand it. And that's where, again, the civil rights movement informs this process. Because one of the things that Dr. King pointed out, without the vote, without the ballot, you cannot have a say in the very fundamental decision making that's going to be happening that tells you about where and how you're going to live, where you can live, but also the quality of life in that community. Now everybody knows when class we have something, as I say, not in my backyard, NIMBY, right? Right? Everybody has an idea what NIMBY is when it comes to a polluting facility? But how many here knows what, other than those who heard me today, who know about PIBY? Okay, from the environmental justice movement was the opposite of NIMBY, was PIBY. Because we found out based upon a study that was done in 1987 at the time I was fighting an incinerator. Based upon that statistical analysis, this is where statistics, the intersection of the statistics, class, past, race, and distribution of resources starts to produce reports that tell you a lot. We found that there was always a high society of polluting and negative amenities in low-income areas. So if you stratify by income, again, going back to the racial stratification that I picked up in this place, you can see how, again, the deck is stacked against the lower classes. But once you even control for rank, for income and stratify by race, the 1987 study, Toxic Waste and Race, very important study by United Church of Christ, by a dear friend of mine, Dr. Benjamin Chavis. The students for that were Renice Miller Travis and Dr. Charles Lee, who right now heads up the EPA's Office of Civil Rights. But these were the folks who actually did that analysis and where the term environmental racism was coined, because they actually were able to link race as an outcome, a significant outcome, when it dealt with land use, zoning, and who were the winners and who were the losers. Going back to Dr. King and the hazardous communities in Memphis, these are heavy bombs to drop. You know, so imagine I came here as a city to help try to fix and sort that stuff out. And so from the outside, you just notice things are happening to your community. But having a program that allows you to, as I say, break this down, and the tools to break this down and translate to this not only to a community, but it also is a powerful tool, as I say, to engage the community to talk about where its power is at and why civil rights and voting rights and the intersectionality of civil rights, voting rights, and environmental rights come together. Because once you recognize that you can either sue after the fact, which it costs a lot of money, or you can mobilize and voter register and educate before the fact, and know what a party platform is, and this is where the political science department, where you start getting into party politics, and what have people tend to just think about Democrat and Republican. It's deeper than that. If you don't know what a Democrat and a Republican is, it means that if you don't know what their party platform is, and how that plays out by race, class, and caste, then you're at a significant disadvantage. And that was one of the other powerful tools that I picked up in this place. So the political science department gave me a set of tools by which I can now understand how the party process was used as a tool to aid and abet the social and racial stratification and hide behind. Because one of the other things about racism is that it is a learning institution, meaning it learns how to cover itself up good, right? It covers itself up real good. One of the things that they use is the politics or statistics of adverse impact. So they know what groups or cohorts are going to be disproportionately affected. And the insidious part about racism, modern racism, is that because you're using statistical outcomes, you know that it will also entrap and ensnare whites as well, but usually the undesirable whites for these folks that make these cynical policies. But who gets really snapped up in many of these negative land, locally wanted, unwanted land use decisions are mainly those marginal areas in which happen to be predominantly minority, poor, or First Nations. They tend to be sold down the river. And because they use nice, what they call formula language, which you don't have to say blacks or Hispanics or Asian or gay, you basically target the demographic variables which disproportionately hit that cohort. So all in all, you will see the burdens and the negative amenities be shifted to these communities. So one has to have a robust set of tools. And one of the things that helped me here in State University of New York in Binghamton, I studied under a gentleman by the name of Dick Rayburn. Not only was he a brilliant statistician, but he was a cyberneticist. And not cybernetics and L. Ron Hubbard, but the ones who were dealing with systems and systems theory. But I also had the blessing and benefit of studying under Emmanuel Wallerstein, who was also a world's systems theorist, and Eddie Weissman, who was a structural systems theorist. And it was the hybrid of these various system theories, and then working out how these things interact, A, within a national level, subnational level, but also a global level, and how they interplay on one another, and how certain factors and agents and actors will benefit while others win and others lose. And you can stratify these things by race. But the point of the matter is, not so much looking at individual actors as in the old days of the Jim Crow America, but look at how these very old wines being passed under new bottles called zoning, as they would say, zoning, land use, political party language, language that sounds neutral. But you heard the terms disproportionate impact. The racism is not in what's said, blacks need not apply, Hispanics or other groups need not apply. You just gotta look at the outcomes. You gotta look at the outcomes and where these things are happening. And this is why, you know, having and being aware about these impacts, you're able to predict what they put someplace and what a community is gonna react. So the case of where I came from, how I came to this movement in the early 80s, after going from Binghamton, I got a nice job in the state capital of New York. Actually, I did a little bit of a hiatus with the United States Navy. This guy in here by the name of Leon Cosler, is he around here? Oh, there you go, Leon.
Welcome back.
You know, there you go. Leon remembers the day I walked in to Albany. And Leon, they know that I was a Binghamton rabble-rouser, radical guy, but this community organizer working with the grassroots. Now, mind you, I had a decent middle-class job with the state of New York, and I could live in the suburbs or live anywhere I want. So I bought some property in this community, which is basically a low-income area, predominantly African-American community. But if I'm going to live in an African community, and if I'm going to give back to the community, at least I want to be at the, as they say, that going back to that land use pattern, at a level of amenities that I want. So I had to have a nice park, a nice school nearby. So I built my house in a place called Dudley Heights up on the hill in Arbor Hill. So Arbor Hill is a big hill. And right up on the parks, because it had to meet my standards, but yet it was in the black community, so I could be organizing and doing a lot of the voting and civil rights and mobilizing there. Not really environmental action, but the environmental side was, like any middle class person, having that clean, green place and space to raise my children was critical. While I taught them about other class structural arrangements and arguments, you know, in a real-time sense. In the middle is a place called Sheridan Hollow. I did not know much about then. And up one over here, this is called Capitol Hill. This is the south of Albany. This is the Hudson River. That's the north. The entire power plant for the Capitol process, or plant, or Capitol government, was something called an Answers Incinerator, which was a state-of-the-art waste-to-energy recovery system, Answers. And it burned garbage for an 8-county waste gym. A lot of suburban counties, as well as the affluent parts of the city. And it was burned right in Arbor Hill. I'm now in Sheridan Hollow, in between Arbor Hill and Capitol Hill. The prevailing wind pattern during the summer is what? Southerly winds. So the wind carried the plume of that state-of-the-art facility over my home. Now, one of the problems with this technology being state-of-the-art, it assumes the big, tall smokestack that it's in a flat field. This is where the science comes, right? We talk about when engineers design something for certain specs and land use, there are a lot of assumptions, a lot of mitigation, a lot of things going. So this big stack, had it been in a playing field, it would have probably carried it further along and away from my community. But it was in a hollow. So the hollow ignored the geography, the topology of the land. And so what happened was the smokestack was actually below my street tree line. So actually even below my street. So where I live, the smokestack's top was below the street. And so on a blustery or windy day, it carried all that toxins at street level. And my home that I built was square in the middle, in the right in dead center. Suffice it to say, my daughters ended up developing something called environmental asthma. That's what brought me to seek answers, seek action, and to leverage all the skill that I even gained here at Binghamton to mobilize and organize that community, but also to try to see what could be done. How could these zone use, these locally unwanted land uses and the zoning of this, how could this thing be zoned there? Well, I then went out and surveyed the community. The community was told that it was going to get free energy, jobs, and that this plant would not produce any harm to the residents in the community. So you had to be not too swift to buy the jobs, and free energy. Well, if you, I took out a slide that's in this, but the median income of that neighborhood at that time was about $10,000. Okay? The majority of the population, about 70%, had less than a high school education, mostly single parent female, many of them working multiple jobs. So in other words, so poor that they could not pay attention. So when this, when they had all the hearings and all the notices following it by the zoning book, this place was ripe to be sandbagged. And that's why that facility was there. But unbeknownst to me, when I built my house, I did not know about all the earlier decision making that went into it. But I had to mobilize and become, as they would say, a significant player and organize this community. So I had to find commonality, had to reach across class and caste, but I also had to become, as they say, a 101 for hard science, political science, civil rights, voting rights, and mobilize the population as to what they could do. Now this was a huge job, and I did not have a lot of the organizing skills, and one of the first organizations I turned to, believe it or not, was the NAACP. They just did not have the bandwidth because they felt it was an environmental matter, and that they just did not understand how they could fit and solve it. And I was going on about this incinerator, as Leon Kosler can tell people, you know, and so some of the folks who worked at our offices were wanting to contact the Sierra Club, and some of the members were members of the Sierra Club, a fellow by the name of Roger Gray. And I said, great, I'll go to the Sierra Club, and perhaps they could get us some of the assistance. This is, you know, in the early 80s. And so long and short of it is that we went down to the Sierra Club, and they voted not to support our community. Because, I mean, there was a whole lengthy story, but it, let me put it to this way. It was bad. So, suffice it to say, at that time I reached out to a guy, Ben Chavis, because they were doing the toxic waste and race study, and the environmental justice movement was picking up, and I linked up with a number of New York City actors, and then I went to the NYPIRG, which also turned us down. But the long and short of it is that we ended up lucking up and getting the NRDC. But a hell of a lot of other grassroots work had to be done to mobilize this community. And, you know, we were able to get it together, organize, shut down this plant, and not only shut the plant down, because a lot of community residents felt that that was a success. You know, that shutting it down, getting it to cease to operate, that constitutes victory. And most poor people don't know how, they're afraid of the courts. When you tell them, no, we got to go to the courts, we got to get damages. Because their interaction with the courts in the judicial system is usually from the point of some crime or et cetera. So they feel that the courts are part of the police and therefore part of the oppression. They don't see the courts as a point of solution and resolution. And so we took this matter to court, we sued, and we won. And not only did we win, we, as I said, this was a very significant settlement because it's the first time in the country that a local community shut down a government facility, held it accountable, okay, got a benefit, as they say, and as they said, in short, this is a very, very huge win. And within the environmental justice movement, this was one of its most significant wins. And so, at this stage, you know, I was able to, as in, and I forgot something that's very important. Back up to when I went to the Sierra Club. So when we got turned down by the Sierra Club, the individual who brought me down, we had a long 3-hour ride back. Within 48 hours, that individual had drafted up a campaign poster and gave me my check, my first check for $250. That was the first investment in our movement. And I made a promise to that individual, Roger Gray, that I would become a Sierra Club member and I would return this favor, but I will also make sure that organization that voted against us would be changed by me. So I made him a solemn promise, which I kept. And so, but it took me a decade still of working within the EJ movement to get that off the ground. So we formed something called the National Black Environmental Justice Network. We developed, you know, the capacity to resist and as they would say, and fight. Let me just go back and fight this. And as I said, and push back, you know, such threats like this that were facing other communities. We took all the lessons learned And within the National Black Environmental Justice Network, built up an entire toolkit on how to organize and mobilize communities that are similarly situated as they seek to resist polluting facilities. And this is where Dr. Robert Bull, I think he just finished his first book on dumping in Dixie. Many of you probably have read Dr. Bob Robert Bull's book. And another piece of the struggle was that we were not only just fighting for other communities and the toxins that were going on in other communities, we were also simultaneously, again, taking that page from the Civil Rights book, lobbying for new legislation and an environmental justice law. In 1992, we were not successful, but we ended up getting an executive order from Bill Clinton. And that's the Environmental Justice Executive Order. And again, environmental justice is rooted in civil rights. It is anchored in the principles of civil rights. And all it is asking is saying, we don't want any special treatment, unique treatment, or side treatment. We want to be treated equally under the law. Going back to that land use model, making sure that we are not singled out and targeted for these facilities, that an analysis would be done and making sure that our communities are not the sinkholes for all toxic endeavors. They're not the places where these things are concentrated. And it was a huge thing to persuade the White House to sign and get that Environmental Justice Executive Order. To this day, it is the tool that has saved countless lives and protected the health of millions of people of color and poor people around the culture, around the country. It is one of the tools that have been used in West Virginia to protect a lot of poor rural white families and farmers. But, that is just only part of the story. Because when you look at that fight and me coming from the university to there, you would think that, well, I'm this civil rights activist kid, and and I come from this urban experience, and so this is my entree into environmentalism. And you would be wrong. You would be wrong. Because my history and my connection to the land is a very old history and connection to the land. I come on my maternal side from sharecroppers. Last year we celebrated the 150th year of the end of the Civil War, right? It's my ancestor grandfather, Zion McKenzie. And that farmland there is still in our family's possession. I come from farmland and farmers, and it was that stewardship of the land that in traditions that were passed on that, again, that allowed our family to survive for generations. During the Depression, before there was anything called welfare or handouts that they stereotypically assigned to blacks, blacks were slaves. We were the ones who worked the land and fed the South. We built the roads. We built the buildings. And it was my ancestor through bondage that, as they said, that provided for his masters, and then through freedom, provide those examples by which the family survived. And land stewardship has been something that has been part of our family DNA for generations. He was the first free, and this property sits in the lower Blue Ridge Mountains of Greenville County in the northwest corner of South Carolina. And that's me, fifth generation on that land. That's my youngest daughter, Olivia, sixth generation on that land. So when I hear environmentalists who think that environmental justice or blacks come from the ghetto or an urban area and they don't have a sense of land use and land protection and stewardship, they're totally wrong. Not only would they be totally wrong, we were part of the First Nations who actually worked the land. Now, this is not to say that all whites did not had slaves. No, they did. But 100% of blacks who were slaves had to work that land. And when we were free, we had to secure that land. We had to pay the taxes on that land. In the wake of the Civil War in the South, there were a whole host of tricks to try to take us off of that land. And we see land refugees to this day as a result of bad economics, bad geopolitics. A lot of things go into A, granting us and giving us the opportunity to legally own the land. Again, going back to that process of laws and, again, the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment. But even once you have the laws on the books, the things that local politicians can pass to strip that land away from you. But this land provided for our family. So my deep sense of organizing and being connected was not something that was born in Harvard Hill. The deep appreciation and the sense of noun and space and what the land means to me, and not the verbal sense, you can see that pride. It's still in our family to this day, and it's going to be passed on to my daughters. The techniques and tools, and remember going back to that earlier chart I had about how the politicians decide, this is that same, that very guy, Zion McKenzie's tax bill. Now, majority of the blacks, my family's less than the 1% of blacks who were able to stay on their land by earning enough money to pay repressive taxes and to resist the Klan and resist all other efforts to try to take their land away from them. Now, we hear about the cavalry and other techniques that you use to force people off land, but this is an 1883 tax bill of Zion McKenzie. You look like you got good eyes. Can you read that math right there?
2,289.
Okay, that was the tax for Zion's land in 1883. This is at the height of Reconstruction. So when you hear about Reconstruction and the tax bill, and now there's something called a poll tax, right? Because if you didn't pay any tax, they could seize your land. So these are the itemized aspect, and here's the poll tax part of it. Son, you got good eyes. What's that poll tax right there?
Is that
one with three zeros?
Yeah.
What was that number?
One with three zeros.
What can you say? What was it?
$1,000.
There you go. $1,000. How many people today have a $1,000 bill for the right to vote? How many whites' ancestors had a $1,000 bill imposed on them just for the right to vote? So when we talk about, think about this, if my family were treated equally, even as Confederates at that time, post-antebellum war, they were treated equally and were allowed to have freedom of access and movement and equal treatment of the law. Imagine where I would have been. I would have probably been the fifth generation at SUNY Binghamton, not the first. So this is how laws and regulation and the intersectionality of these things play out at the regulatory, this is what politicians control. When we talk about institutional racism, this is it in this forefront. This is a snapshot from Reconstruction, okay? And this shows you, literally, school tax, ordinary county tax, state tax, but you know, the whole total tax bill for a man with 16 kids was $2,281. So they had a massive amount of land because during Reconstruction they worked for the Union Army and they got paid real gold wage, real wages, and they were paid in gold. And that allowed them to buy a lot of land. He knew he had to have a lot of land. And since a lot of the South was rebuilding, he had a lot of lumber on his land. So he sold a lot of lumber. So he was like a big supplier in the construction and the raw materials, and that helped him weather this. But that's not a good thing. Because at the end of the day, you see how he was ripped off and how the trick was set that if he didn't pay this, he would be stripped and forced off. And then at the same time, they were passing something called anti-vagrancy laws. So blacks who lost their land under this regimen, they lost their land, they were what? Wandering the streets. They were arrested. They were put on chain gangs. And they were back on the very plantations working again, this time as criminals, because of vagrancy created by laws that were repressive like this. And this caused a huge migration, a huge population, this economic oppression, this stripping away of the land of a people, caused huge migrations of blacks from the South to the North, which created what kind of antagonisms and competition in urban centers for low-wage labor. And pitted these poor blacks, because racism pushed North, to compete for jobs and depressed wages in the North. And again, the Trumps of their day, you know, blaming them as lazy and shiftless. As you can see, my ancestor was not lazy and shiftless. He earned the income to pay Pharaoh's bricks without straw taxes. But he did something even much more powerful. That right there is what? A registration certificate. He voted. The power of the vote, the power to influence and register protests because you paid that tax, but to exercise that franchise, is one of the most significant elements. And that is one of the things that has been with my family for generations, the power of the vote. No matter what they think of you or how they feel about you, the wealthiest man can vote as many times as you can. They don't have that much more over you. And if you organize and mobilize your community like my ancestor did, you can absolutely, as they say, form those community cooperatives to protect your land and protect your family. But this was the exception, and this was something that was exceptionally rare. Now, fast forward that to conditions like with the NAFTA or other things that are causing populations, once the people lose either through the environment or through politics and have to migrate north for wages and jobs, and how they would come back with the argument of, oh, these people are here competing, but not looking at the legal or legislative framework that forces these population migrations. But again, these are people who were wise stewards of the land, raised their revenue, and paid their bills. And this, as I say, underpinning is not just only for my family. There are a lot of blacks that have very, very similar stories. My ancestors, my dad and them, who settled in Peekskill, there were men with very common and similar stories. And it's through that awareness and their struggle in the civil rights and voting rights movement and the consciousness from that, and carrying that forward, that notion of collectivism and collective organizing in one's class interest was a critical piece. But recognizing the intersectionality of politics, voting power, land rights, and land use, and how that was controlled by one segment, and how one's race could put one at a disadvantage, really, as I said, was a shared point of commonality, but also a shared point of organizing power. So when we organized the environmental justice movement, one of the things that we ended up at was the Southwest Organizing Project, and we had a massive conference there in which we send the top, this is in 1990, remember, I'm not a member of the Sierra Club yet, this is 1990 here, and we sent the top 10 environmental organizations a letter. And it's a promissory note that we told them that they were default. They're saying that, in short, if they speak on behalf of the environment and all humanity, that we demanded our place at the table. And we pointed out, and we made the case on how we earned it as, again, as people who live and occupy the space, but more importantly, as those who are burdened and have a special burden based upon the history and legacy. And again, that history and legacy, in my family, it's a real tangible thing. And fast forward that to about, I want to say about 1999. Now I was ready to become that member of the Sierra Club. Now it was time for me to move from a new movement called the Environmental Justice Movement. Now it was time for me, in follow on to that letter that we sent out through the SOC Organizing Committee, to take delivery. And that delivery was to, as they say, to break that green ceiling, to move into environmental organizations, to help transform them and to make them much more egalitarian places. So I began with a chapter, worked my way up through the chapter, and as I met resistance at the chapter, the great thing about the Sierra Club is that you can spring off into what they call a national organizing committee. So if you got resistance and discrimination at one level, you can actually find relief at another level. What you don't find is at the front door coming in. You learn about these things on the inside. But my issue was not being hung up on the resistance. Mine was going in to transform and change that organization. Now, I knew it was a grassroots organization, but still, the point of policy occurred where you shape the regulatory framework for that organization at its national level. So being on its national committees was the place where I had to come about and bring about systemic change within the organization. And helping them form, as they would say, a environmental justice committee, also the trainings for dismantling racism, class awareness and sensitivity, and building those pieces in, we're able, as they would say, to push for systemic change within that organization. And then later on, at the national level, going to the organizations and entities that finance, because it's not enough to deal with the Environmental Organization Act, so you have to go to the foundations and saying, listen, if you finance organizations and environmental organizations in the status quo as you do right now, just for a particular action and activity, that's no guarantee by which you can make them, as I say, diverse and inclusive organizations. But more importantly, most of the greatest harm in the environment happens to be occurring at fence line communities and communities of color. And so we're asking you to make the demands on these organizations to become diverse entities. And if the funders are going to be asking these entities to become diverse entities, we know that the organizations eventually will follow. So a lot of that struggle during the 90s was pushing for not only shaping the culture of the environmental organization, but also the funders of those environmental organizations. Again, shaping the values financially, which is the economic fuel, but internally at the core, at the belief level. So one of the things that we did go after was insisting internally during the 90s through our EJ programs internally was asking, as I said, look at diversity within your organization. Because diversity is more than just calling for numbers. It's also about bringing in those experiences, those different points of view or perspectives on the environment, those different perspectives on life and organizing, those different perspectives with regards to the noun of place and space and how we value things, but evaluate it through the eyes of First Nations, Latinos, Blacks, Gays, and break down the practices that, as I say, institutionalized bad behavior, and go after, as I say, the brain and the heart and the central nervous system that on one level is supposedly fighting for a clean environment, but maintaining oppressive structures that, as I say, that still discriminate. So it's transforming the way the psyche and the heart, as I say, and the nervous system of the organization was a critical piece. And then not only just hold the environmental organizations through the executive order, through the White House, and through other connections to our EJ movement, was also going after federal agencies and highlighting them and coming up with new policies by which they, as I say, they interact with communities with regards to the environment. But more importantly, pressing at the NGO level, pressing at the higher levels, and at the UN, because it was very involved in the UN as well, because by the year 2000, it was the environmental justice community that was sounding the earliest alarms on climate change. In fact, it was during the Bali Accords that the people of color's comments with regards to climate were moved forward by the indigenous nations and the domestic U.S. EJ organizations. And leveraging that effort, you know, and pushing for diversity and pushing for that voice really had a significant point of impact, but also it gave us a powerful voice at that international level. So what ended up happening was we used that north-south divide between first world and third world to transform a within first world conversation and build leadership. And the thing is that we also had with us not only calling them out, but calling them in, you know, and pointing out the benefits of diversity, and that diversity is not a burden, it's a value. And if you talk about dealing with the present issues with regards to the environment, that diversity is going to be one of your critical values that any environmental organization must engage and must embrace, specifically in the wake of one of the most significant threats that we're facing right now, which is climate. And so you cannot be serious about saving the planet, and you cannot be serious about taking on the challenges of the environment if you are not a diverse organization. So once we weave in these threads and start to do some of the remedial work to transform entities like the Sierra Club and making them much more diverse organizations, but much more effective organizations, but we want to also institutionalize these values and moving past that race conversation. But the critical thing is to start that conversation. We had to deal with the elephant that was in the room, and that was one of that critical parts of that struggle. And dealing with racism, so a lot of environmental organizations, you say racism to people, people just freak out. Are you calling me a racist? Well, you know, depends on what your reaction is. Racism is, you know, again, you know, going back to the substratum, it's the mud filter, you know? You know, folks, no matter how poor a white person was, you know, you knew that you had it better than a black person, right? And so in dealing with these institutional privileges that never went away, they were just remasked and packaged as something else. They were masked and packaged as affluent neighborhoods that were only of one group of people. They were the Irish only or the Italians only. You know, so things just morph and go on. But the thing is that tearing down those institutions and tearing down those old assumptions and recognize rather than moving into dividing us, that we have to have arguments that pull us together to face the real threats. And whether it's labor, remember, racism and classism are critical organizing tools for the capitalists. They make a lot of money when workers are competing against one another, when ethnic groups are competing against one another. And so, you know, the lack of diversity in these old models have been very profitable for, as I say, past institutions. And so when you start to advocate for diversity and inclusion, you tear down racism, you now start to focus on the real problems and real threats and the real challenges, but more importantly, the real problems in society, those who cause them. So the current threat, the current crisis, you know, I talk about rapidly moving through, but the thing is being mindful that we have a real serious crisis. We called out the climate issue back in 2002. And while we're struggling to build a national environmental justice and an international environmental justice, we were becoming, and I became a member of the Sierra Club, rising through its ranks to push that message that we need to build a climate movement. And actually, it's only been within the past 5 to 6 years that we actually are at a place and space of coming together from a point of mutuality. We have a lot of work still to do. But the point of the matter is recognizing who that serious threat is. In this place and space is the carbon issue. And they're relying upon the same tactics that have been around since the days of Jim Crow. Class, divide, and conquer, blaming it upon race, appealing to the base levels in society to keep the working classes from coming together. Transcending these arguments and bringing people together and looking at the threats that many of us first face, whether we're First Nations, as Brother, Congressman Keith Ellis, Brother Tom Goldtoo, and that's his son Dallas, and you guys know who that funny looking guy is, and it's Allison Chin. But the point of the matter is recognizing and building the infrastructure and support networks, but more importantly, building that interdisciplinary and cultural, cross-cultural intersections that allows us to come together, as I say, and fight on behalf of the climate. And by the way, Tom Goldtooth's community is one of the communities where they have a lot of fracking, a lot of pipelines, Dakota Access, the Bakken fields, a lot of that is happening on indigenous people's lands. But within the organization, building class solidarity within the organization, the members of the old environmental justice team, and now they've evolved into our diversity team. But the point of the matter is, this is going back in the early 80s when we began pulling together folks from Appalachia, Dallas, North and South, East and West, and shaping the values that would ultimately transform this organization. And when this is successful, then we're able to come out in class solidarity to fight against, in this case, the Bakken crude trains that were basically being stockpiled in poor areas of upstate New York, not just upstate New York, but throughout the country, but mainly through poor communities. And again, the battle for climate is a burden that, as we said here, mainly borne by low income. In most cases, a lot of the threats with regards to climate change, as I said, the process and the raw end with regards to the transport, shipment, and as I say, the processing is occurring mainly in low income and minority areas. And this is something that's not new. So are the negative amenities. This is the Bikini Atoll, the Marshall Islands. This, back during the 40s, it was a place where we tested atomic bombs. But today, these communities are the frontline, baseline communities in global sea rise. And so right now, they are the ground zero. These are whole brown nations that are facing the front end threats. And so when we're over at the UN, we were fighting for something called damages and loss that basically a lot of these low-income minority nations are facing as frontline communities. And the Marshall Islands is an excellent example of this. They bore the burdens of the past, and now the burdens of the future. And unfortunately, this was stripped out. The Article 5 and Article 2 were stripped out. Things with regards to just transition, non-exploitative of women and children, non-exploitative practices, the right of labor to organize, basically making sure that if we're going forward as to deal with climate change and climate strategies, that it will not be on the backs of the labor, the poor, women, and marginalized populations. These things were pulled out. And one of the biggest voices to pull that out were entities like the U.S. Chamber of Commerce abroad, because they were saying free market solutions were the best way to go, not government-led solutions. And meanwhile, they're saying, and they were acknowledging that climate change was real, but they were suggesting that only the markets could determine whether or not there would be viable solutions. But that very same U.S. Chamber of Commerce in the back in the United States were actually the entities that were supporting what? Climate denial. So and at the global conference, they were talking about they're aware that there are four solutions, but domestically, so they had an A and a B game. And without our people on the front lines, you wouldn't be able to witness this. And so to that end, we went over there, First Nations, EJ organizations, the Sierra Club, and again, we organized around the unity there. And this is, again, taking labor, the environmentalists, experts from various disciplines, and coming together and recognizing that, you know, there are certain burdens, and more importantly, that we want to push more than just an agreement. We actually wanted a treaty, and we still are pushing for this, but the need to protect those vulnerable populations. And this is something that was very powerful. And we pushed for just transition, because one of the things that they were arguing for was that the effort to push for and finance new technologies, but to do so using the first world's dirty labor practices, meaning that they want to use right-to-work legislation to develop clean, green technology. And our argument is that it cannot be clean, green technology solely defined upon its output, but even how it's produced, its supply chain, where does it come from, what labor practices are going in, are they sustainable, are they just, are they equitable? So all that old intersectionality was very, very, very critical. And again, for me, it's not something pie in the sky. That's my old dad. You know, it is from an organized labor standpoint, and recognize that with living wages, union wages, you, as I say, you help push societies from falling into that race to the bottom and accepting dirty deals whereby they will produce solar panels, but their workers have no rights. If you ever look at what goes into producing your iPhone and the labor practices that go to look into your, as I said, developing the raw materials for your iPhone, these are criminal. But what we're saying is that as we reboot this whole system to fight climate change, we must also reboot the system with regards to labor practice and, as I said, how we treat humanity. And that at this international agreement, that we want to make sure that the intersectionality of good, clean jobs, clean soil, clean air, clean water, are very critical principles. But also, if we're going to build the clean tech industry for tomorrow to fight off climate change, it has to be at a minimum, at a core. Again, going back to that Maslin hierarchy, that labor and the right to organize is very critical. Because again, you can look at West Virginia. When a company fails to transition or is anchored into dirty fuels, a lot of the working poor start fighting for dirty energy, right? A lot of the West Virginians fighting for coal because there's no adequate just transition or no proposition or pathway forward for that community. And our argument is that you must build that in. If we're going to talk about climate solution, that these things must be built in. And we were calling out Renault Nissan. They built a nice product called the Nissan Leaf. But in Renault, in France, and in Japan, they have organized labor. But in the United States, the Renault and Lisi plant is built in a place in Mississippi that was on a former plantation in a right-to-work area. So the fact and the irony of using blacks and their inability to organize in the state and pushing for, as I say, clean technology and saying, well, no, we're still looking for a solution, but to do it without the rights and principles of labor to organize, to protect themselves, is really just an unjust solution. And more importantly, it's as dangerous as burning dirty fuels. Because again, it keeps people in a trap where they will make false choices. And that line, that, as I say, that, you know, pushes them in a path of, as I say, of unsustainability. And one of the things, you know, we pushed was, you know, what are the ways to go forward? Again, highlighting the intersectionality of all these things that, you know, to fight against carbon and keeping it in the ground, we have to pull all these communities together. But to do that, it must be done in a holistic and sustainable way. We cannot have a disconnect between legislation, policy, income, and more importantly, the old dividing line in the United States, which is race and the other ugly politics that come that go with it. So to that end, one of the projects that we, the Sierra Club, under my watch, created was something called the Democracy Initiative. And that's where we basically pooled our skills and lessons learned and built intersectionality with labor, NAACP, and various civil rights and social justice organizations to define that pathway forward to build tomorrow's clean, green economy. And this is critical, and this is where you come in. Because at the end of the day, the solutions, you know, are not, as I say, in the old technologies, in the old industries that are out there, in the old arrangements that are out there, but it's actually here at universities like this where you have an interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary approach that deals with the classism, sexism, racism, homophobia that have been used systematically to distract and divide our society, which we see playing out right now in national politics, and pull us away from, as I say, looking towards sustainable solutions, but looking forward to this body to build new ways forward by which communities are coming together. Because at the end of the day, you know, it is about building a global climate movement, a global climate march. And it's recognizing that everything that we're doing right now comes upon legacies of bad practices and institutions. And my presence as president of the Sierra Club is helping the organization leading a way forward using civil rights, using environmental rights, using my now analytics from political science, using my analytics from systems and system dynamics, and how do we pull together to build this multifaceted but complex but necessary movement. And the proof was in the pudding, because we had the massive climate march in New York City, and the diversity there was stunning. But what also was powerful about this movement was that all these college students, all the youth in high school, I mean the youth in the youthful side of the movement, you guys get this. You guys are coming to this game with the intersection network. I did not, when I came to this university, have the programs that were in place that allowed me to pull together all the disciplines, but also even having the literature classes, the rhetoric classes that help put together and frame the arguments so that you can help make the cases. So this is one of the things, the gifts I got from this university, and one of the blessings to come back here and say thank you, but also be a bear witness to the programs that you guys have created now that are come in the wake of programs that were around when I was been here. But anyway, I want to say thank you. I want to thank you all for your contributions going forward, but also for the work that the faculty with regards to the programs they put together for you with the interdisciplinary approach to seeking climate solutions. And with that, I'll close my talk. Oh, I want to do one more slide. We talked about the things that I've done. There, this was when I got arrested at D.C. You know, and again, this is going up, forcing Congress to do its work. And this is going up against the oil industry and the oil cartels that own Congress. And I got jailed. And this was our democracy awakening. This is, again, this is all the labor, poor rights, rural whites, rural whites, rich white, black, poor, all of us coming together, sharing and pooling that technology, recognizing that there's no one pathway. It's the diversity of the movement that should also reflect the diversity in the environment and moving forward. Our battles on the Hudson, again, as we peel back the onion in the battle with regards to the incinerator, coming together and then leveraging that change in the Sierra Club to bring about change. You know who that guy is, fighting at the international level. And yes, celebrating our great legacy, and yes, my Scottish heritage, as my family tartan, as my Jamaican side, you know, not the South Carolina side, but I went around South Carolina with that thing, I would get into quite a bit of trouble. But the point of the matter is, the message is resonating, because at the end of the day, having the president come to Yosemite to thank you, thank us, thank the Sierra Club, and thank the environmental movement for advancing the Clean Power Plan, and advancing the clean energy solutions, and also pushing for more open spaces and more wild places and spaces, not only just in the traditional areas, but also national monuments that recognize history, like in Stonewall, New York, and that these things can come in many places and spaces, and getting that president in the space and, as I said, expanding that inclusive message to, as I say, protecting and saving wonders that are of historical and heritage significance to all people and groups. It's been, as I say, a powerful ride. So all these things amongst, this is just a very, 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 very quick highlight, but many of these things I've been able to do with the wind and the energy and the knowledge and the skills that I was able to pick up here at this great university with the great faculty, people like Linda Lisman, and witnesses like Leon Cosler, who watch, as I say, to take that energy, that talent, as he shut down incinerators, to become an advisor to presidents, governors, and other national leaders, and as it shape and build this movement. So thank you. I've got a few minutes for questions.